And so, you read the scripture portion first of all. The armor of God. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Tells right there, there's schemes against us. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's not against people. But against the rulers, against the authorities, not our government. Against the powers of this dark world. And against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. It reminds me of a very Esther-ish type of situation. If you know the story of Esther, she asked the king that her people might be able to defend themselves, because some had been trying to kill the Jews, and she said, well, let us defend ourselves. And they were able to stand in the day, the dark day, when it came. Well, I'm going to share a bit of my story because growing up in church, you know, I've maybe heard three times in my 30 years of going to church, I guess 28, because I didn't really pay attention until I got to grade 12. Sorry. I had incredible Sunday school teachers, and they really made it so I really had a good grasp of what was happening. I'm not sure if this is recording or not. Does anybody know?
Yes, it is.
It is. Perfect. Just want to make sure. All right. So, the funny thing is about part of my story is I never thought after 16 years old that I would ever be going to St. John again in my life. Drive through? Sure. Go to? Nope. Why? I'll tell you why. When an RCMP officer, after an hour-long interview, tells you and your parents that that young man should never, ever go back to St. John ever again, you listen. What was Andrew doing? Was he carjacking? No. Though I did have a teenager once from Hillsboro that carjacked in St. John and he got busted. He didn't go back to St. John either. Was I dealing drugs? Nope, that's not part of my testimony. My testimony is that I was raised in a Christian home. My parents loved Jesus Christ. I was brought up in the church. I had incredible Sunday school teachers. I had a healthy church to go to. And then at about the age of 16, pretty much everything fell apart. I think of Psalms 46. It says, even though the earth be removed and the shattered, the Lord will still be my refuge. And so this point in time came where everything fell apart. My church split. The senior pastor made a big boo-boo. I won't go into all the details there. And my youth pastors at the time, I want to say they invested in me so incredibly. It's Guy Myers at Brown's Flats and John Crawford at Grace Presbyterian. They were my youth pastors. And they invested in me so strongly. But you know what? They were going into ministry and they had to go to Acadia. And so they left our church and they went off to Wolfville. And I was like, no, I will come visit you. I have a car, but I will walk there. And, you know, you can get as a teenager, you just love these people who pour into your life. And so I became kind of, you could say, very alone, very vulnerable. And I had just been baptized at 16 years of age. And at this point in my life, I'd say I was dealing with a lot of self-righteousness. I probably had a little bit of that sneaky thing called pride. You know, it was just kind of in there. It was like, I'm a pretty good Christian. And I probably had reason for thinking that because a lot of my other teen Christian friends, they were saying, you know what, God, I'm doing my own thing. You know, so there's a lot of people that were saying, whatever to God. And so I thought, man, I'm the only teen Christian I know. And I always thank Spring Forth because it always reminded me that there are thousands of other Christian teenagers who love the Lord Jesus Christ and want to live for him. Not perfect, but you know what? They're going for it. And so, after being baptized, my church fell apart. I don't think it was because I got baptized, mind you. But I became a little lost. You know, I didn't have a senior pastor, didn't have any youth pastors, and I was desperately looking for a home. I was looking for a place to connect with and connect to. And so I started going to different youth groups. I'd go to the Pentecost youth group. I'd go to the Catholic church. I'd go to the Anglican church. I'd go, if there was a church with a crossover, I went to explore. I went to find out, okay, God, if this is no longer home base, where is home base? Where do I fit? Where am I going to be nurtured? Who needs me? You know, just Captain Andrew here, ready for service. Yeah, I did have a bit of an attitude back then. Anyhow, in my journeys, I ended up going to an Anglican youth rally, and, you know, the story has nothing against Anglicans. I enjoyed my Anglican friends at a youth rally. Of course I'm going to go to your youth rally. And we had a blast. And it was there that I met this very spiritual lady, and we started having this great conversation. Some of my friends, you got to meet this lady. You'll so enjoy talking with her. And so I was like, yeah, I'll meet this lady. You know, and she tells me that she's a youth pastor, and I'm really excited. I'm like, wow, you know, I think I found the person that's going to help me to get to the next level, the next person that, you know, I could find some home with. But she lived in St. John. I was like, well, this is going to be hard, so what can we do? Well, we exchanged phone numbers, we exchanged pen pals, we started writing letters to each other every week, probably. We'd get a letter back and forth, and then she'd call about 10 o'clock at night. We'd talk and chat about spiritual things and pray till almost midnight, sometimes even later. And, you know, we were developing this friendship, and I was really feeling fed in my spirit. I was feeling that I had finally found a new youth pastor that's going to take me under their wing and love on me and teach me things and disciple me. And so we had this chance to go to her place in St. John for a youth rally. Well, I was all about the youth rallies, right? Other Christian kids, yes! You know, so you go there, and maybe you'll find the one. You know, your teenage years, like, who am I going to marry, right? And so, 16, probably didn't need to get married. Anyhow, so we went up there, and I was kind of like, huh, this is interesting, the youth rally's at your house. All right, but we were all there. Some of my friends were there, it was six or seven of us. And we were going to be going to Caton's Island the next day to get together with the other youth groups for the youth rally. I said, oh, okay, that makes sense. Well, that first night when we went to bed, and the next morning, two people I was talking with had a dream about a wolf. And they were really scared. It was a nightmare. And they both woke up being chased by a wolf. And so another friend came by, and they had been talking with this youth pastor lady, and they held up a piece of paper. Do you mean this wolf? Three different teens had a dream about a wolf. And one guy had drawn it, and the other two were like, yeah, that's the one. I'm 16. I'm fairly naive at this point. I mean, I think I'm smart. I think I know what's going on. I think I've got a good grasp. I'm just about everything in my spiritual walk. And, you know, I was a little full of myself. Let's be honest. And so we went to King's Island to be part of the youth rally, which was kind of an all-day event, and there was lots of fun things happening. But it started to feel to me and my friends and to other people on the island that there was an oppression. We started feeling a very thick oppression. And the only way you can describe it is a heaviness, you know, a physical heaviness. I mean, like gravity feels heavier, right? Your heart feels heavier. And we'd start to pray, and we'd start to sing, we'd get in a circle, and when we would sing and when we would pray, I'm not making this up, the sun would come out. It was overcast. The sun would come up. We would stop singing, we would stop praying, and we'd get overcast again. And we could almost, I don't want to say do it on command, but every time we sang and prayed, the sun came out. Every time we stopped, get overcast. It was pretty freaky, you know? So we started becoming aware of this oppression. And as it got closer to dark, things started getting creepy, you know? And that's what we're talking about today, spiritual warfare. And I don't just mean, like, you know, praying or these kind of things. I mean when the enemy manifests itself in a real way. My mentor has told me often, he says, the enemy always overplays his cards. You know, maybe you haven't had any of these experiences, and maybe you think, Andrew, you are so full of garbage. Well, you know, this is my story, and I got witnesses. So as the night gets going on, people are starting to get freaked out. They start to see eyes in the woods, you know. Maybe it's just they're getting a little out of order. It's hard to say, right? We're at a camp. People are kind of like, ooh, right? But people were genuinely getting a little creeped out. And about 10 o'clock at night, I can remember someone said, Andrew, they need you upstairs. We were in a big barn complex, and as I went upstairs, the impression got stronger and stronger and stronger. And when I went upstairs, there was three people that I had met and had known were laying on the floor, and well, yeah, the word possession definitely comes to mind. And there's my youth pastor friend praying for them. And I say to myself, oh, here we go, right? You know, this is what I was praying for. Again, a bit full of myself. But I can remember I went to go pray, and I knew my scriptures. I knew what scripture said. You know, if you're disciples of Christ, you know, in the name of the Lord, these things will be cast out. And I went and did what I thought the Bible said to do, and guess what happened? Nothing. Not a blessed thing. They were still doing a bit of compulsion. They were still doing some weird things. And I'll tell you, I've never been so scared in my life. And there's other things that went on that night that defy rationality. We'll just say it that way. And things I can't explain, except that it was very clearly not of this world. And exhausted. I mean, you're praying, you're doing the best you can, you don't know what to do, and you're wondering what's happening, and I mean, like, there's a lot of weird noise. And the crazy thing is, the next morning, we've been up all night, sun comes up, things all seem to calm down, the sun comes up, don't know how that, why that works that way. We went downstairs, and we are bedraggled. We've been up all night praying, and I'm thinking, like, I am the most, it was very humbling, because I thought, well, this isn't how it works. This isn't how it works. What? And I just, it really twisted my mind. Like, what? How? I don't understand. And we come downstairs, and there's some people down there. They were just kind of crashed out. And I'm like, and there's a room full of people. And I was like, you guys slept through that? They're like, slept through what? I mean, we're not, it's only like a 10-foot high ceiling. They never heard a thing. And they were awake when all this stuff, I mean, just weird stuff, right? So I was totally exhausted spiritually. I don't know if you can get exhausted spiritually, but I think after I preach a sermon, I usually need a nap because I've just given out and poured out so much. And that night, I'd given out and poured out so much. And I can remember I'd laid down on a picnic table, and the lady youth pastor was there and a couple of our friends, and she said, why don't you pray one more time? And I said, I can't pray anymore. I'm really tired. I said, oh, pray one more time. And I prayed one more time. And I swear, like, it wasn't an audible sound, but I felt something break in me. And to be honest, I didn't pray for what, another year and a half, maybe 2 years. And for a few years after that, even into my 20s, I would get claustrophobic in prayer meetings. God has helped me through that. I do enjoy to pray now. But this is part of my experience. This is part of my life story. And over these, before we had that youth rally, she'd come to the house sometimes with her kids, and you know, we'd kind of get along and hang out. But we got back to her place after the youth rally, and I can still remember the oppression came back. I mean, it followed us home. Oh my goodness, what do we do? Well, I can remember I was laying on the floor watching TV. We're watching David the movie, right? How bad can that be, right? No word of a lie. I felt as solid as someone doing that tapped my shoulder. I looked around, who tapped my shoulder? There was no one within 6 feet of me. No one had done it. My friends decided that it was time to pray, and they started to try praying in the house. They could not pray in the house. The oppression was that thick. They left the house to go outside and pray. And I'm alone in this lady's living room, and she's on her chair, and she's looking at me with steeple fingers. And no word of a lie, an image of a wolf passed in my mind over her face. And I was like, oh, that was weird. And I suddenly know I'm in trouble. I'm so naive, I have no idea how I'm in trouble. She gets up off her chair, and she's walking towards me. And I am scared as I've ever been in my life. Roller coasters ain't got nothing on this one. I don't even know what's wrong. I just know I'm terrified. She's about 2 feet away from me when all of a sudden there's a knock on the door. And I tell you, I got up off that floor. I ran to that door as quick as could be. And I opened it up. My parents were at the door. They had been at a church. And the preacher was preaching Nehemiah 4:14. It says, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes. And when I saw my parents, I started to cry. And it wasn't, it was not elegant. It was the snot, like, it was embarrassingly terrible. But I knew that I'd been saved. And I tell you, I didn't even know what I'd been saved from, but I knew that I'd been saved. I didn't even know why. So innocent and unsuspecting. They drove an Oldsmobile that should not have made it from Moncton to St. John. They came to get me. The impression was so strong from God to come and save their little boy. There was some legal action taken against this lady because of some of the things, one of the kids who had been, if you say possessed, I'm not sure what was going on 100%, but pretty much. And the RCMP officer interviewed me for over an hour. And I don't sweat too often, unless I'm playing basketball or such. I'll tell you, I had to change my shirt after that one. I've never had so much respect for RCMP as at that moment, I'm telling you. He said very specifically to my parents that I should have nothing to do with that lady, and I should have nothing to do with St. John, and then he mentioned the occult. And that word kind of stuck in the back of my head, and I thought, well, I'm still naive at this point, I'm not thinking things through, but that word stuck in my head and said, well, no, she's a youth pastor, she wouldn't be involved in the occult. So a year later, when all the puzzle pieces came together for me, one of my buddies who had connection with this lady, over the year, he had been trying to get me to go to her house. And he had a car, a Trans Am, we'd get there pretty quick. And he said, oh, just come with me. And I kept going back to the fact of what is said in Scripture. Children, obey your parents and you'll have a long life. And I really did respect my parents. And I had a lot of opportunities to go see this lady, and I said, you know what? No, I'm going to respect my parents out of principle. Of course I wanted to see her. She was one of my friends, right? She wanted to spiritually invest in me. She wanted to more than spiritually invest in me. As my friend told me, he said, you know, she wanted you. I said, yeah, I know she wanted to see me. He looked at me, grabbed me by the shoulders, looked me in the eye and said, Andrew, she wanted you. And I'm like, what? What do you mean she wanted me? And he was very blunt. He said, she wanted to have sex with you. I was like, how could you ever know that? He said, because when we were having pillow talk, I asked her, I said, you didn't really want me. You wanted Andrew, didn't you? She got my buddy. He didn't come from a Christian home. He's pretty loose and fancy free anyways. But he was a Christian. And it was like my life flashed before my very eyes. All the little puzzle pieces, all the nuances from phone calls, from when I'd seen her, all these things. You know, we'd be talking about the occult sometimes, and she'd talk about things from a very experienced point of view, and I never put things together. And then I started thinking about that night, and I started thinking about how she was praying. And I realized she wasn't praying for the kids in a lot of ways. She was spirit channeling. And that's in Scripture, folks. As Christians, we're not supposed to dabble in the occult. We're not supposed to dabble in those things. Our God is a jealous God. The spiritual gifts are real. I've seen them. My favorite thing I've ever seen was I was working with a street mission in Moncton, and when you're dealing with street people and the occult stuff, you need God to show up in that kind of way. And we were at Keddie's Brunswick Motel, and above us was a psychic fair, and so we had someone come in who operated some spiritual gifts and said, come on down and see God at work. Their mouths just dropped wide open. They'd never seen anything like that legitimate before. Anyhow, that's another story for another day. But God had protected me from myself. He had put in place coverings over my life, umbrellas, if you want to say it. He had protected me because I had put myself under submission to my parents. But you know what? I could have easily walked out from underneath that umbrella of protection. No, I didn't have a youth pastor that I could say, oh, I did have a youth pastor, except come to find out, she was more than likely a witch, or at least into the occult, and she was a wolf. She was not a youth pastor. I can even remember looking back, we went and visited her church, and they didn't talk to her like she was a youth pastor. She was involved in the service. I mean, all the signs were there, but I was too naive, and I was too vulnerable, because I didn't have a covering. I didn't have anyone, I had my parents. And God could use them and speak to them to speak into my life. There are some things I've learned the hard way about spiritual warfare. I've never heard talk too much, but I'm going to share some of these things with you, because if you're parents, you have kids, and the Bible is clear that we do have an enemy, but the thing is, the enemy doesn't always strike out loud like that. You know, he doesn't. A lot of times we get comfortable, and then once in a while you get like a glass of ice cold water splash your face, like, oh, right, we're in a spiritual war. I forgot about that. It's real. I like to ignore it. I don't go looking for this stuff. Sometimes it finds me. It finds me in the weirdest times. I don't go looking for it. We shouldn't go looking for it. That's not how this stuff works. So I want to share just a couple things that I've learned, because I think it'll help you. Because I wish that someone would have shared some of the stuff with me. One thing I've learned is that the spiritual realm is highly legal. Our Bible is made up of the New and Old Testament, the New and Old Covenant. Hebrews 8:6 says, but in fact, the ministry Jesus has received is as superior to theirs, referring to angels, as the covenant of which he is the mediator. It is superior to the old one, since the new covenant is established on better promises. There's a legal system in place when it comes to the spiritual realm. We, my friends, are part of the kingdom of heaven. What makes a kingdom? Well, there's a king, and there's a set of laws that we live by. Thankfully, we also have grace in ours. The Bible lays down in the Old Testament a system of sacrifice, and the New Testament are sacrifices made by Jesus Christ, and we're under grace. The blood of Jesus Christ is powerful. Maybe there's somebody here that has made a pact with the devil, or maybe you've been cursed, or maybe there's a generational thing. And I'm telling you, I've seen that stuff. It's real. But I want to let you know today that the blood of Jesus Christ is superior. It is a stronger, it is a higher legal authority, and it can break the chains that are in your life. Being a youth pastor, sometimes teens experiment and they get into some weird stuff. I'll never forget one of my teens. She had dreams, very vivid dreams. She'd been messing with the occult, and she'd make pacts and different things, and she would dream that she was in a cage and being tortured and scratched, and she'd wake up with wounds on her body. And I said, you need the Lord Jesus Christ in your life, and you need to have that broken. She accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior, and that was the end of those dreams. Because the blood of Jesus Christ is the highest authority when it comes to those things. If you've made any other kind of pact, when you come into agreement with Jesus Christ, you've come into agreement with the Lord God, and all that stuff has been paid because of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is also an umbrella. There's spiritual umbrellas. Now, the Bible doesn't say, get under your umbrella, folks, right? It doesn't say that. But it talks about headship. It talks about submission. It talks about all these things. And I honestly think that part of the reason I was so vulnerable to have this happen is because my church had split. I didn't have a senior pastor to go to ask questions. I didn't have my youth pastors to ask questions to. I had a wolf. And I had actually submitted myself to her authority. I came under her realm. That is why when I prayed and tried to cast demons, nothing happened. Why? Because she was inviting them in. I was under her authority. God has put shepherds in place. Me. God is the head of the church. And you have pastors that are a form of a headship. We've become a spiritual umbrella for you. Even youth pastors become an umbrella for the teens. God will tell us shepherds things so that we can do things about it. I'll never forget, I went to go see one of my teens when I was a youth pastor. And I knew I needed to go, and I drove into the parking lot. And as I got out of my car, it was bitter cold, but it was summer. And there was a wind just going around his house. And I walked up the stairs to go to the apartment, and I could sense in my heart that it was a spirit of suicide. How do I know that? Well, God just whispered it to my heart. Didn't know it for sure, but it's what was impressed on my heart. Opened the door, closed the door, and it was a totally different atmosphere because his mom was a praying mom. And he was walking out the door, he had a glazed look on his face, and I said, "You turn around." We went in, had a cup of tea, talked him down, talked about a few things. He never admitted at that point to wanting to commit suicide until about a year later. He says, "Yep, I had it all planned out. I was going to go walk outside, and I had my place where I was going to hang myself." And you know, there's times that you have your shepherds in place that God can tell them to be praying for you, to intervene for you, to intercede for you. I'm glad we have a youth pastor. I really miss Stuart today. You know that? He needs a vacation, so that's what he's doing. But you know, we depend on each other. We also know that, in my case, Ephesians 6:1-4 says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with you, and you may live long on the earth." If I had disobeyed my parents, if I had gotten out from underneath the umbrella, it's hard to say if I'd even be in ministry today. I'd be one messed up little puppy. If we are under submission to this kingdom of God, we also don't go around in spiritual warfare going crazy. What do I mean by that? Well, I took a course on prayer once, and in that course, we were taught to pray against the spirits of the north, the south, the east, and the west. Well, all right, let's do it, right? It was a video series we were watching. And so in my prayer time, my personal prayer times, I pray against the spirits of the north, then the east, then the west, and the south. I was getting a little cocky again, right? Taking those guys down. Look at me, Captain Andrew on duty. I will never forget, after about a few days of doing this, I'm in my room, I'm in my 20s, and there is a dark, cold presence in my room. I mean, I'm not engaged in any sin, I'm not engaged in anything like that. There's no reason for this thing to be in my room. And I'm like, what the heck? Crank the praise music, and it's still just lingering. And I'm like, what is going on? I don't understand. So it left after about an hour or so. I just had the impression I was being, like, intimidated, right? Almost like Mufasa from The Lion King, just kind of like walking around little Simba. And I'm like, "Ooh, baby, where's my daddy?" Right? And I remember going to talk to my academic dean at the time, and he said, "What? You're not supposed to do that." Come to find out other students had the same experience. So that course got changed. Anyhow, what I've discovered is that if we're part of the kingdom of God, if we're soldiers in the kingdom of God, we don't just go shooting stuff, right? You don't hear me going after the Hells Angels. I'm sure there's Hells Angels in St. John's, a big city, right? I don't go after them. You know what I do? I love the people that God has put in my life. That's what I'm supposed to do. When you go about doing those kind of things, you start shooting at the enemy and God hasn't told you to. You know what happens? If you're on the front lines and you start shooting randomly, A, your teammates are like, "What are you doing?" B, snipers on the other side are like, "Oh, look at that muzzle flare. I'll just kind of bat." Right? We shoot where God tells us to. When we pray, we need to ask God, "How do you want me to pray about the situation?" Well, what do you do though? What if you are in your home, and in your home, you feel a dark presence? What do you do? We're on slide 7 if it's working. I'm not sure if it's working. That's all good. Well, you don't have to be afraid. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind." And again, if you know, if you've been around the Bible, you know that whenever it says do not be afraid, it's scary. Right? But we need to be bold, we need to be courageous, we need to pray, we need to ask God for help. So there's a few things I've found that have helped. Crank the praise music. You know, don't wait for something to happen. You know, there's a Christian radio station. If you have an internet and a computer, just log in. Don't even log in, just click on the Christian music. Permeate your house with the praises of the Lord. Maybe you have a favorite Christian worship CD. Permeate your house. Change the atmosphere. I mean, it's not wrong to listen to secular music. I do too, right? So, I mean, if you crank a little Van Halen for a while, just don't forget to put a little, you know, some of these other Christian guys, Chris Tomlin or something. You know, the other thing you have to ask is do a repent or a heart check. Have I given legal permission for something to come to my house? Have I been playing with Ouija boards, tarot cards? Have I been, watching something I shouldn't be watching? Has someone in my house let something in? You know, have my kids been exploring this stuff? What's going on, right? Keep a G-rated house. I think that's a good idea. The other thing you do, we moved into our house in Hillsboro a few years back, and when we got there, the mom, Wendy, she put scripture notes on sticky notes all through her house. Her boys were crazy. I love those kids. But, you know, she had those scriptures up everywhere, all through her house, so that, you know, her house would be permeated with scripture as well. I think, too, if anything like that, if you have a visitor in your house, so to speak, listen closely to God. Is God sharing any information with you? You know, there's some things in Scripture, there's sometimes the disciples are trying to cast something out, and Jesus said, oh, guys, listen, that one doesn't come out without fasting. Right? Oh! Right? Paul confronting the sorcerer on his first mission trip. I think Paul just in his own mind said, oh, be blind? I think God told him, yeah, blind that guy. Or the girl with the power to see the future. After weeks of anointing, going, these are the people of God, these are the prophets of God. You know, after about a week of that, you know, Paul looked back and said, shut up in the name of the Lord, and, you know, cast the demon out. But how God wants you to handle these situations, you know, we have to listen to him, see what he says. You know, you don't have to handle alone either. You know, you can call your pastor, you can call a deacon, you can call somebody in leadership, you can call a friend, you can call your mom. I remember once I was coming back from a ministry, I was working on Grammy Nan, and I came home for a visit. I had a night terror, and it was like brutal. And when I woke up from my night terror, it was blacker than black, and the black receded out my window, and little faces and creepy stuff, and I was scared again. You know what I did? I didn't stay in my room. I went and got my mom. My mom said, you know, God told me I was supposed to pray for you before you went to bed tonight, and I didn't. I was like, pray for me now! You know, but I remember in my dream just being attacked, and in my dream I just knew all I had to do was say the name of Jesus. And when I said the name of Jesus, it was just like, Jesus! Boom! Right? It's like, the name of Jesus is so powerful. So powerful. Especially when it's a real situation, right? And I also want to come across as well, you know, not every difficult situation we come across is spiritual warfare at this magnitude, at this level. Sometimes we look for things, for demons behind every corner. You know, sometimes it's just life. You know, addictions probably feel like, you know, you got a demon on your shoulder. You know what? A lot of times it's physiologically, and you need God to heal your mind. You know, mental illness, you know what? I wouldn't even say it's demonic. You know, it's sometimes you need a psychiatric evaluation. Sometimes you need to be on meds. You know, not every single situation is an attack. I don't go a little long, so I'm going to wrap it up here shortly. There are seasons in life when you can expect a little more trouble. And this is what I've seen. When it comes to salvation, when someone is going to get saved, whether it's you or a friend, man, sometimes you can just hear the thunder rolling. I can remember a a service where the guy was giving a message, and in my heart of hearts, I knew that God was looking at my friend in the balcony and pressing on his heart and saying, you need to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know what? He didn't. And I asked him afterwards, I said, was God, you know, in your heart? He said, yep. Why didn't you? I'm not ready for that. Wow. Baptism. I've noticed that when someone is getting ready to be baptized, or just after they get baptized, there's a lot of warfare that goes on. And I think partially, when you come to the tent, you're publicly declaring war. You're publicly declaring sides. And it irks the enemy, I think. But God is faithful. Ministry. If you're doing good ministry, the enemy loves nothing better than to divide, send hopelessness or defeat, financial struggle, rumors, irrational behavior. I knew a fellow that he and his wife, he was the worship leader, he and his wife would fight every Sunday morning religiously. I said, did you ever think that maybe it's because you're about to lead worship? And the enemy doesn't want you to have a clean heart when you get up on stage? He's like, no. He and his wife started praying every Sunday morning. Guess what happened? Less fights on Sunday morning. Not no fights, because that wouldn't be human, but less fights. I find people are also very vulnerable when they move or change cities. You know, there's a vulnerability there, and you need to find a home church because you're not under the same amount of umbrellas, so to speak. So I'm going to close with this. Stay under your umbrellas. Stay under the truth that you know to be true. Stay connected to your church. I mean, sometimes I'm sure I ask people, hey, do you want to become a member? It's mostly because I'm just selfish and want you for my own. But it's not even membership. Do you have a church family that loves you and will watch after you? Someone that you can call on in tough times? It's important to not be vulnerable. It's important to be under God's umbrellas. Also, don't let the fear of the enemy keep you from following what God wants you to do. You know, we don't not go forward because we're afraid the enemy might attack us as a church. No, we're going to go where God tells us. And when we go where God wants us to go, when he wants us to go, we fall under his umbrella of protection. Trust that his faithfulness will see you through to the end. If the enemy does attack, know that you must be doing something right in order to ascertain his ire. More often than not, though, you're not going to have to deal with this stuff. I don't imagine. But know that God is your defender and your strong tower, and he will provide protection. We dwell under the shadow of the Almighty and find ourselves under his faithful wing. Psalm 91 says, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High, picture the umbrella, will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he's my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare, the tricks of the enemy, and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side. If you say, the Lord is my refuge, though, and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. We serve a faithful God. Amen. I'm going to ask the team to come up, and I'm going to just have a word of prayer, and we're going to sing, "Great is thy faithfulness," because he is so faithful. I thank God that he saved and protected me in my situation, and he will do the same for you. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you have given us those protections, those umbrellas, those people in our lives, this church family, your scriptures, your truth, to help guide us and lead us to be under the shadow of the wings of the Almighty. Lord, be with these parents that are here today as they raise their children. Give them wisdom. Give them compassion. Lord, be with the grandparents that are here today. Give them wisdom and compassion. Lord, we're all your sons and daughters here today. And we ask that you would grace us with your presence, grace us with your wisdom, and we thank you for your faithfulness and your divine protection. We pray these things in your name.